It's a fantastic opportunity to establish baseline data on our physical qualities, but also then to use the information we're collecting to try and create these targeted programs. We've got these three different interests or motivations. We might be interested in gathering rehab baselines. We may be more interested in looking at it from an injury risk management perspective. And we might also be interested in physical performance enhancement. But of course, so often these are overlapping motivations. Data that we collect on physical qualities of our athletes can serve purpose in all of these areas, which is handy for us really in terms of testing efficiently. Whilst I'm going to talk about physical qualities using an injury risk management framework, I'm certainly not dismissing the importance of building physical qualities. In general, there is so much overlap between these capacities for both injury risk benefits as well as physical performance. Perhaps the most obvious here, think about eccentric hamstring strength and the benefits of that to a footballer, both from an injury risk perspective as well as physical performance. I really love this framework that was put together by Mark Rowe and his colleagues. It's this six-stage operational framework that outlines injury risk management in professional team sports. I think it's a really nice framework to make sure that we've got a rounded viewpoint of our sport and integrating the data that we're collecting to actually make an impact. Stages one and two then relate to injury trends and risk factors. Stages three and four are all about profiling and understanding the demands both of the sport as a whole and then the specific athletes in front of you. And then stage five and six, we move on to the actual monitoring of the athlete and the management of them through evidence-based interventions. So let's dive into each of these areas. And firstly, then injury trends. Many of you will have come, perhaps you'll be ready for next preseason to start in the coming weeks here. How many of you have actually dived into the injury statistics from last season? I'm hoping the majority, because we certainly collect all this information. We have legal demand to actually keep a track of the injuries that are occurring and keep these medical records. But it's a really important process to go through actually conducting an injury audit for your team each season to understand the incidents, the severity, the re-injury rates that your athletes have suffered from, to look for pattern. Of course, we know that injury is complex and sometimes humans oversimplify things and find patterns where there perhaps aren't any. But still looking at those trends, comparing to what we see in the literature for what are the usual injury rates in a specific sport and population, just to understand as your starting point for your injury risk management framework and understand where these trends are within your team. As I mentioned, looking at it population specific as well is really important. So here, this is a little bit dated now, and I'm sure hopefully we have more research coming out given the increased attention on women's football. But from a number of years ago, there was this notable difference in trends between male footballers and female footballers. So again, making sure you're understanding the injury trends in your population as a whole, but then also your club and organization where you're at. We can then relate that injury audit to an understanding of risk factors. Use this figure an awful lot because I think it's really critical for us to understand. Whilst it is important to have research that dives into the association and the potential relationship between a single risk factor or a single physical quality and injury risk, so we can understand that on a basic level, we always need to keep in mind that in reality, risk factors are complex. So this web of determinants illustrates this dynamic, so changing and interactive web of these different risk factors, that the thickness of the border here shows the different impact that that risk factor is having on that individual's injury risk profile, which emerges, and then it is recursive. So certainly understanding risk factors and potentially conducting tests for individual risk factors is important and very worthwhile, as we'll talk about in more detail, but always keeping in mind this complexity that is the reality of injuries. And then we move on to understanding the profiling of the sport demands. This is both relates to the training load perspective we were just talking about. So what does a session, a pre-season, a season in football in this case look like? What are the demands physically? But also then drilling down into our specific demands and understanding those on a deeper level. So here, of course, we have Mr. Deceleration, Damien Harper, who has moved on our understanding so much around deceleration with his framework showing all the different factors that underpin someone's horizontal deceleration ability. We can start to see then how these capacities, which may also be risk factors, as I spoke about, link into the different demands of the sport, and therefore why we may want to profile them, why we might want to screen for it, and why we may then want to train it. And as well as, of course, understanding the sport as a whole, we also then need to move on to profiling our specific athlete. Of course, this is where VALD helps us out endlessly with the various technologies, tools, and tests that we have available to us. So again, our understanding of the sport can help guide what capacities we actually test for. We also, so there we had the example, of course, of the individual athlete. We may then want to loop that in. Here we have an example from the VALD Hub taken from the preseason guide showing how we would get a viewpoint across our whole squad and understand the variance within the squad of a particular capacity. And collectively, then we can use that information to profile our athletes against the rest of the squad, against the rest of their position group, and against themselves if we have historical data. So people who have consumed some of my content will probably know that I love Z-scores and I love a radar plot. I think it's such a simple way of visualizing where someone is at compared to a comparison data set. So we've collected all of that data for our specific sport and individual, but then what does that actually mean? And often I say to people who are collecting data or presenting information, what is the so what? So what does that mean? What does that mean for the athlete? Do they need to work on something? Do they not need to work on something else in this case? What does it mean for the coach, for the practitioners? And we need to not just present data, we need to make it actionable. So when we're profiling our athletes, we should be thinking about what do these results translate into in the real world setting? And that's then when we come onto our athlete management. So again, that same paper from Mark Rowe, they illustrated this nicely in terms of thinking about your interventions across these different levels of approach. So some athletes, there will be a group approach, and that might be a warm-up. Perhaps everyone does the same thing. We then have other kind of interventions where we have a cluster approach, and we might modify that. That could be based on playing position. For instance, our goalkeepers might have a different approach, or it might be based on grouping, based on some of their screening data, whether that's based on their physical capacities or what we think actually are their key work-ons in terms of injury risk. So you might have a hamstring group, a groin group, ankle group, or it might be driven by the DSI, for instance, in terms of those who need to work more on match strength, or those who need to work more on ballistic explosive demands. And then we have another level as well in terms of this individualized approach, right? We sprinkle on these other interventions specifically for that intervention, for that individual, based on their profiling. So that's the athlete management. And then, of course, there is the monitoring aspect and continuing this ongoing loop. I think it's important we touch on the monitoring piece, because so often we do fall into this trap, quite frankly, of testing all these tests in pre-season and then not repeating them again. Some tests you can potentially justify that, if depending on what the results are and how you're using it. But we again need to be really intentional, I think, here with like how, if we're going to set a goal and an intervention based on our screening and our testing, how are we then monitoring the effectiveness of the program relative to the initial goal? Are we closing the loop here? So this is quite an interesting debate, I think, because I'm currently still a firm believer that we should test intentionally. We should use that framework to guide what we're going to test and why we're going to test it. Of course, given the advances in AI, machine learning, some might argue that it's better we collect as much data as possible so that we can put it into our models and maybe find some magic number or some gold dust from it. I don't think, in my opinion, we're at that point yet with that technology. And I think we also have a responsibility to our athletes to make real use of any data that they are providing us with, as well, of course, as the time that they are giving up to do it. So in the practitioner guide we created, Alex and Tara had some input as well on this figure in terms of the 5 W's and the 1 H. It's not a very catchy title, but I'm told that's what this approach is called, where we're really planning out what are we testing, who is doing it, when are we going to do it, where are we doing it, how are we doing it, and critically, why are we doing it, and how are we going to use that information? I think even the process of putting this plan down on paper can be really valuable. And literally a couple of hours ago today, I was having a conversation with a colleague about the preseason planning discussions that they have and what they have planned. And I said to her, something always goes wrong. Give yourself more time, give yourself more leeway than you think you need, because the reality of preseason testing is more often than not different in real life than it is on paper. And one thing that I often talk about and relate very crucially in preseason is this value burden matrix, that we want to get high value out of any data we collect. We want it to have an impact, to use it. Ideally, we want that to be a low burden. And I'm talking about burden on the athletes, but I'm also talking about burden on the staff and the resources required to actually make use of that information. Now, sometimes we could justify a high burden data collection if there is sufficient value to it, but certainly we want to be avoiding altogether any low value data collection processes. So I think if there's kind of one question I would urge people to go away tonight, tomorrow, Monday morning from this, my talk at least, is to really reflect on how valuable is the information going to be that I've planned to collect. Did I really make use of it last year? If not, then can you adjust how you use it? Can you change that implementation? Or the retesting perhaps could be a factor. But if not, really question yourself as to, is this going to add sufficient value for the burden that it's going to place on the staff and the athletes to collect it? So the framework in summary then, as I said, I know it's got an injury risk focus, but I think it nicely actually links in as well with our physical qualities and the capacities that we want to profile on our athletes and then actually intervene based on. And then the summary overall, let's remember that preseason really does lay the foundations for the entire season. So ideally we go into it with this intention, with this planning, with the ability to adjust. And in this case, as I've spoken about, thinking about these three different dimensions of the training volume, the training intensity, as well as then those physical qualities, and approaching them with intention.